Shalom from Jerusalem, and I'm sitting in my sukkah. This is the last day of sukkahs. The next holiday is coming up is Simchat Torah. And of course, I'd like to talk about Simchat Torah. We're here in field conditions, so if there's any noises, you understand. Now, the holiday of Simchat Torah is a crucial point. It's a day that connects the beginning and the end. Well, first of all, we're finishing Torah and we're beginning Torah, starting to read Torah again. It's a finish of the seven-day holiday of Sukkot. Simchat Torah is a separate holiday, but nevertheless, it's conclusion. It's also a conclusion of the cycle of three holidays, Pesach, Shavuot, Sukkot. So what's so special about Simchat Torah? It's interesting that what we're doing in 7 weeks, remember 7 weeks, 7 days, 50 days between Pesach and Shavuot, every week there is the energy of certain sphira, right, Ches and Gvura and so on, and the work we have to do in this 50 day to raise ourselves to a very high level. Similar work we have to do in the holiday of Sukkot. There's 7 days, and we said there are seven ushpizim, seven guests that comes to us, because sitting in a sukkah, it's really being in Gan Eden. It's like returning to the Garden of Eden. So who lives in Garden of Eden? Our forefathers, they come to visit us, but our forefathers, as you remember, is archetypes of different manifestation of God, if you wish, in this world, and different manifestation in us. Avram is Chesed, is kindness. Avram is Gur, is properly put borders. Tiferet is Yaakov, and so on. And so now, on Simchat Torah, seven circles of dancing with Torah represent the same thing, but in one dance. So you see, it's all comes together. Now, a little bit about Jewish dancing. You see, Jewish dancing is a prayer with entire body. And that's why we do it separately. We pray separately because it was put very nicely that the prayer is a vertical experience. You know, it's like you want to be together with God and not a horizontal experience where you're experiencing something around you. If I'm sitting next to a pretty woman, be that my wife, be that somebody else, I will be distracted, and I don't want this distraction. And I don't want it in prayer, and even more so, I don't want it in dance, where I'm praying with my entire body. See, when in the sacral dancing, men dancing with women, there's always energy. There's always chemistry, if you wish. If there's none, then the dancing is very, very cold. So that's why the secular people don't understand very often Jewish dancing. It feels strange or boring. Why? Because how can you experience the same energy to a person of the same sex? You know, there's a man in front of you. But that's the whole point. You come with completely different energy. You're dancing with God. And so when you realize that that's the energy of the Jewish dance, it's really a prayer. And again, every circle, every time you dance with Torah, you dance, or even without Torah, it doesn't matter. You know, it's you dance, it's chesed, it's an energy of chesed, and then you feel the energy of gur, the energy of tiferet, of beauty, and so on and so on. So that's the reality of the Jewish dance. Now, you go higher and higher and higher. This is the day, as I said, where we're finishing the Torah and we're beginning the Torah. The last letter in the Torah is Lamed, El, in Israel. The beginning of the Torah is Bereshit. The first letter is Bet. Together, the word Lev. Lev is a heart. So the connection between the beginning and the end, meaning the entire Torah, it's about the heart. It's about correcting ourselves, correcting our emotions, correcting the character traits. That's what really is it's all about. If we would look a little bit more into the last phrase of the Torah, and remember, Torah is not even, it's not a circle, it's a spiral, if you wish. It's like, but we're coming back to the same points, but we go higher and higher and higher. So it says that there's a, we talk about the last sentences, talk about the strong hand and awesome power the Moshe performed before the eyes of Israel. So if we break the sentences a little different, we say, before the eyes of Israel, that's the end of the Torah, and the beginning of the Torah, Bereshit bara Elokim, v'shamayim v'sa'aretz, meaning, in the eyes of all Israel, in the beginning, God created the heaven and earth. Interestingly enough, that Rashi, very famous commentary, said that Israel is called the beginning, the Reshit. The Torah is called the Reshit, the beginning. So what is it talking about here is that Israel was the name of humanity. Adam was supposed to become Israel if he didn't eat from the tree of knowledge and good and evil. It means there would be no Jews or non-Jews. The whole humanity would become Israel. So for humanity, for us, for Israel, the world is created. And again, remember the world is created every second, every instant. So it's a new creation for us. It starts a new cycle of creation. Now, when we talk about the world, we're not talking about only outside the world, we're also talking about the inner world. That for us, God creates the whole world and He helps us to create our inner world for us as well. Now, when let's talk about Moshe Rabbeinu, and they talk about this awesome power that Moshe performed. Interesting, Rav Tradman, he brings down, he says, brings down Rashi again, and Rashi says, what are those miracles that Moshe performed in front of Israel? And the answer is very strange. This is, he said, the tablets, the luchas that Moshe broke in front of everybody. And God says, this is a great thing that you did this. Now, out of all the miracles, this is a miracle. But if we look at the Bereshit, if we look at creation, again, what the mystical tradition is talking about, that Bereshit is about breaking of the vessels. It's a breaking about the vessels. Why? To create more complex vessels that be able to experience the entire creation. So we're seeing, again, the Jews on Sinai. We're witnessing the entire creation of the world, and after that the breakdown, and then there is a tshuva, then another, why is it we are recreating ourselves. And interestingly enough, you see the last two portions that we read right after Rosh Hashanah, it's about tshuva, it's about blessing, and it connects to the new beginning. Now, what does God tell us on this day? Us, meaning Jews. He says that it's just me and you. There's nobody else. You did the work for entire nations. We brought 70, bulls for the entire nations. We did all this work. Now it's me and you. So after it was a couple of years ago, and last year also, after all the prayers, I was sitting, and I just wanted to meditate, meaning concentrate, focus on God's presence. And of course, my evil inclination was bothering me, so it was flies. And I said, God, you said it's just you and me, and there's nobody else. So why is the flies here? Why is the evil inclination even here? And all of a sudden, it was like an answer, as I felt, yes, you're right. And all of a sudden, zoof, and there was nothing there. It was just me and God. And it's an unbelievable experience, just being in the presence of, Almighty. And I want to give everybody a blessing that we should all experience this incredible experience on that day, because this is the highest day of the year where we can experience it. So I wish everybody a great Simchat Torah from Jerusalem. Shalom, shalom.